together, and now you're all going to go home, and the first thing somebody says, how was the Sirius Symposium? And you're going to talk about sheltering in place for the tornado. Okay, so we do have a very, very short program, so if we can interrupt the current conversations of the posters, and then as soon as the program is done, we'll go back to mingling. So Jay Ackridge is the Provost and Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs and Diversity, with a faculty appointment as Professor of Agricultural Economics. He previously served 8+ years as the Glenn W. Sample Dean of Agriculture, where he had administrative responsibility for the Academic Research Extension and International Program of the college. Jay served as the Interim Vice Provost for Engagement at Purdue in 2007 and 8, and was the Interim Dean of Agriculture in 2008-2009. Before moving into administration, Jay was the James and Lois Ackerman Professor of Agricultural Economics and served as the Director for the Center of Food and Agricultural Business and the MS-MBA in Food and Agribusiness Management Program here at Purdue. He currently serves as the Chair of the Association of the Public and Land-Grant Universities on the Policy Board of Directors and has served in a variety of leadership roles with the APLU. He is the recipient of the Charles Murphy Award for Distinguished Undergraduate Teaching, is listed in the Purdue Book of Great Teachers. He is named a university faculty scholar in the year 2000, and his research focused on strategic management of food and agribusiness firms. He received his master's degree and doctorate in agricultural economics at Purdue and a bachelor's degree from Murray State University in Murray, Kentucky. And has been a long supporter of One Sirius mission and our outreach. It is a great honor to introduce to you the Provost for Purdue University, Professor Jay Ackridge.
Thanks much, Joel. Appreciate the introduction. So, I'm going to say it's great to be here at this exciting event, but it's been a very exciting evening. Hope you enjoyed the tour of the Purdue Dungeons, and a special bonus for your conference. And someone was looking for the wine cellar down there, but I don't think they found it. But anyway, we're glad you're here. Indiana weather is what it is. 6 inches of snow yesterday, tornadoes today. So that's West Lafayette, Indiana. I'm going to be especially brief given the weather delay, but it is my privilege to introduce our guest speaker tonight. We are delighted to have all of you here on the campus for this important 20th anniversary celebration of Sirius, and especially delighted to have all these student posters here tonight and the good work these folks are doing. Obviously, future professionals in your industry, and I understand they're competing for some prize money. So I think we ought to give our students a round of applause for their great work. Let's give them a round of applause. I certainly want to acknowledge the sponsors that are with us here this evening. We appreciate the financial support you provide for Sirius, but also the connections you make with our students and our faculty while you're here. I mean, this is the essence of a land-grant university, bringing industry together with students, with researchers, staying focused on relevant problems, and we appreciate everything our sponsors do to help us do just that. I also know we've got a number of individuals back with us for this 20th anniversary, faculty, staff, and students that have helped develop and build Sirius into the world-class center that it is today, and we want to acknowledge your contributions as well. And then a special thanks, of course, to Managing Director Dr. Rasmus, our Interim Director Dr. Zhu, and of course, the Executive Director Emeritus, Jeez Maverick. We're going to introduce him here in just a moment. I'd like to give those folks a round of applause as well. I know SPAF's going to talk about the history of the center, so I won't get into that. But anybody knows launching a new venture, launching something like this, takes vision, it takes persistence, it takes passion. It takes someone to really sell people on an idea. And I understand, you know, the President Beery And Provost Randall, Executive Vice President of Academic Affairs Randall, had gotten word that lots of folks were interested in some of staff's ideas, and they said, we need to set something up, a center at Purdue University, to do work in information and data security. And Sirius then was born, and there was only one person to lead that center, and the people around campus called him SPAF. You know, I did a little bit of digging on SPAF, and as I said, someone who launches something like this has got a lot of characteristics. They got to be creative, they got to have passion for the topic, they got to have vision, because again, this was 20 years ago, and this topic certainly was not as hot and center of all of our conscience as it is today. But that was SPAF. And some of you might have heard it. He did an interview with Jeffrey Boast, the Ghost, at the University of Minnesota. And he confessed that when his parents brought home the World Book Encyclopedia when he was young, he sat down and read the whole thing, cover to cover, over the course of a year. He read the whole set. Those of you that know SPAF are not surprised that he would do something like that as a young man. But fortunately for us, he brought that tenacity, that love of learning to this university. And he told Ghost in that same interview, I'm at Purdue because I see that there are things that can be done to make a difference. And again, he's going to recap the history of the center, but this is an impressive, impressive interview. You know, this center has involved over 100 faculty, more than 20 departments since its inception. Started the first information security master's and PhD program in the world, and now I've seen more than 250 affiliated PhDs graduate. And through its outreach, alumni and visitors helped to create or enhance information security courses at hundreds of other colleges and universities around the world. It's no surprise that this center, Sirius, has consistently been ranked as the world's best or one of the world's best working in this particular space. And it's also no surprise that SPAF has been recognized with accolades from dozens and dozens of sources. His honors, awards, and accolades go on and on. Recognition from federal government, governor of Indiana, and prestigious academic organizations around the world. And one of the things he's most passionate about, we talked about it tonight, was students, learning, and making connections like you're seeing this evening between students and industry. I did find out that he's created such an impact, there's even an internet page that's devoted to his pithy sayings. And here's one of my favorite SPAFisms. And this is SPAF, and I quote, "The only system which is truly secure is one which is switched off and unplugged, locked in a titanium line safe, buried in a concrete bunker, surrounded by nerve gas, with highly paid armed guards. Even then, I wouldn't stick my life on it." So SPAF's the person who tells it like it is, and we're going to have him tell it like it was and recap the center, the history of Sirius. Please join me in welcoming Executive Director Emeritus and Founder of Sirius, Dr. Gene Spaff.
Suddenly you're silent. No, I'm not going to announce another tornado warning. So, this was an interesting experience for me to go back through my records, going back really about 23 years to pull out material to put together a history. And I don't know how long you'll be able to stand still for this, but I'll try and give you a synopsis of some of the major things that happened in starting the center and in getting things going. And I view it roughly as 3 6-year periods that I was the director or executive director. The last two I've been emeritus. And the first 6 years really is organization and energy and building something. So last year's symposium, I mentioned about the COAST laboratory that Sam Wagstaff and I started in CS. To build on research in this area of information security. And over the 5-year run of Sirius, we had several dozen students who were involved, and we attracted the participation of Mike Atala, Tim Kaur, and Marlene Walls, who's somewhere here, started work for me as an administrative assistant. We also had some other faculty who were involved in COAST at the time. Carla Broadley, Aditya Mather, Keong Park, Tony Hosking, H.J. Siegel, Michael Young, and Vince Russo. Most of those people are no longer at Purdue. But what happened over those 5 years is we connected with a number of companies who were really interested in what we were doing and our students. They included Sun Microsystems, Bell Labs, Schlumberger, HP, MITRE, Sprint, and Bell Northern Research, and gave us a fair amount of funding to pursue various research ideas. What happened, though, is that many of the things they were interested in were not computer science. They involved issues of psychology, of economics, of management, of education, and other areas. And what happened is that I would say a large number of my colleagues in CS were unhappy that we were teaching courses or working in areas that they didn't consider to be part of computer sciences. Interestingly, some of those same faculty are still with the department and still believe that computer science is a fad. So take that for what you will. We weren't really sure where we were going to go. And several other universities, as the provost mentioned, had contacted me about maybe I would be interested in moving to those places and setting up a larger scale effort in information security. The provost at the time, Robert Ringel, heard about this and approached me and said, why would you do that? Why would you move from Purdue? And I explained that CS was kind of a training entity, and these other places were talking about doing something at a university level. And he said, well, we can do that here. Let's have a meeting. And so I met with him and with Stephen Buring, who was the president at the time. And they asked basically what it would take to create an entity at the university as a center. Then on, I think it was May 7th, 1988, we publicly announced the formation of Sirius. 98, excuse me. It's all a blur. I remember May 7th, though. We had an event over in the anniversary drawing room to announce the founding of Sirius. And they provided funding to help get it off the ground. So we got this was big money at the time. We got $15,000 from the provost, $35,000 from the College of Science, and $35,000 from the CS department. A couple months later, we managed to win a reinvestment fund amount of $75,000 and began renovation of our offices over in Recitation. Also, I worked with Harry Morrison, the dean, and wrote a proposal to the Lilly Foundation. And in December, they awarded the university $4.9 million. About $500,000 was for Discovery Park, or not Discovery Park, but for the Purdue Research Park, but the remainder was for Sirius. This was very exciting. It gave us a tremendous start. And within that first year, a number of faculty around campus became involved. So Bharat Bhargava, who is here, Micah Tala continued, Victor Raskin, Jens Paulsberg, who's since left, John Rice, who's retired, Shimon Knopf over in industrial engineering, Alok Chaturvedi, who's in management, Paul Thompson, who was in philosophy, and he has left, Michael Stoll, who was in political science, and he's left. But we pretty immediately got faculty from 7 different departments to be involved. With the money that was available, I made 2 wonderfully strategic hires. Worked out better than I thought. The first was Steve Hare, who became the first managing director, because I didn't want to have to deal with filling out all the paperwork. I wanted to actually work on promoting our research, finding new ideas, getting students involved. The second one was serving in CS at the time, and that was at that time, her name was Andra Short, now Andra Martinez, and Andra's here somewhere, right there, for our first director of outreach. And I remember telling her that it was a soft money position, which means it wasn't guaranteed. And the expectation was she was supposed to raise enough in sponsor donations to cover her salary and I was going to give her a year to do that. So I think it was about 5 months, and she had covered her salary and that of at least one other person. So it was a great start. She was able to help us really get off the ground and was also the person who spearheaded the development of our first strategic plan. Shortly thereafter, I hired Lori Floyd, and Lori should be here somewhere. Where's Lori? Over there. There's Lori. Lori came on board as our first receptionist, and she had been working as the business office clerk for the Coast Laboratory prior to that. Lori is the only staff person who has been to every symposium that Sirius has ever had. All the others have either retired or left for other positions. So that's a great distinction, I think, for Lori. We also hired Mary Jo Maslin, who retired a few years ago, and headed on towards creating an enterprise to foster research here at the university. Within the first year, we hosted a presidential commission, the NSTAC, for those of you who know what that is, here at Purdue. And by providing some seed funding and guidance to existing faculty who were not working in security as they understood it, we had 43 funded research projects by the end of the first calendar year. We had started a partner program with other universities, and we lured Gene Schultz, some of you either knew Gene or have read some of his work, to come to Purdue as a visitor to help teach classes because we didn't have enough capacity. By the fall, we had established our partner program, and I say Andrew was really significant in that. Cisco and Sun Microsystems were both founding sponsors who made very significant contributions in terms of equipment to us. But we also had Citigroup, Anderson Consulting, which shortly thereafter became Accenture, Schlumberger, Tripwire, TRW, Anita, which was an Indiana Technology Association, HP, Intel, Lockheed, Microsoft, MITRE, GE Labs, Triton Data Systems, and AT&T Labs West Coast. That was within a year, so we really hit the ground running. And at that time, Elisa Bertino was here as a visitor on sabbatical. The next year, we started expanding a little bit in programs, and we hosted the second RAID workshop. This is the Research Advances in Intrusion Detection, Recent Advances in Intrusion Detection. And Deb Frinke, who's down here, was co-chair of that with me. She was at the University of Idaho at the time. And it was really that workshop that then transitioned that into a major conference. We also hosted a vulnerability workshop for people in the community about how do we report and recognize vulnerabilities. And that led very directly to MITRE establishing the CVE program, which I expect many of you know about. So both of those were outgrowths of our second year here, which was pretty good. Then, because we had so many sponsors, we needed more room, we opened up in a secondary office over in the PTC, in the Purdue Technology Center, where we had offices and personnel from HP, Tripwire, MITRE, Symantec, and Netegy. They came to campus to work with us and to work with students. This is a model that was followed again in later years by RSA and Cypress. But we were, even then, attracting companies to establish branch offices here next to Purdue. The following year, we had 23 more projects, and I hired Judy Lewandowski and Melissa Dark to work on staff. Particularly, Judy was to work K-12, and Melissa was to work continuing education, because NSF and other agencies require an educational component for their big proposals. So they were going to create one as an outgrowth of the center that faculty could then use on those grants. Unfortunately, over a period of 3 years, I was the only person to ever use those in a grant proposal. For whatever reason, the faculty didn't want to do that, and so those offices eventually went away. But we also added more faculty from communication, nuclear engineering, psychology, CIT, and education. In our third year, which was 2000-2001, we established the world's first information security graduate degree, the INSEC program. And we also graduated our first PhD student who had started in Sirius, and that was Taryn Lane, for any of you who know. We had a number of other, we sponsored the first Sirius conference. We had a Guru's workshop that was sponsored by Anderson. Pascal Mounier joined us as a research scientist after having been a student, and Pascal was here. Is he still here? No, I think he may have left. But Pascal was with us then for 10 years working as a research scientist. We were up to 22 sponsors. We were named a NSA Center of Academic Excellence, and we started an affiliate program with other universities. 01-02 was a little bit trying. Gene Schultz left to go back to his regular employment. Andrew left after getting married. Steve Hare left to take a position as an assistant VP in ITAP. Judy left to go take a teaching position elsewhere. Our webmaster, Vince Kozer, left, and who's our system administrator, and our web administrator, Kent Wirt, left. This was not something I did to cause this. They all assured me of that. But it was simply a matter of they had worked here, shown what they could do, and they all went to better positions. So that was a little difficult. In particular, I had arranged to take calendar year 2002 on sabbatical. I was going to go and be a special advisor to the director of the NSA for the year. And the day before we were supposed to sign the paperwork to have that happen, I was with a group of other faculty at the NSA awaiting a briefing on counterterrorism when the planes flew into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. And the director, Mike Hayden, said, it may not be a good time for you to come. So I said, okay, I guess I won't do that. Maybe I'll take my sabbatical to just work on a book or something. And then Andrew, Steve, Judy, Vince, and Kent all left, and I got to do all their jobs for a few months. Not for long, we hired Teresa Bennett. Randy Bond, is Randy, where's Randy? Is he here, right there? So Randy was hired there in 2002 as the managing director. Adam Hammer, where's Adam? Over there. Adam was hired for system administration. He's still with the center. And Ed Finkler is our webmaster. Pascal had some success with a program called Cassandra, which we made available to the community for vulnerability management. And 2002, we had a new, fresh, kind of interesting assistant professor join us that we thought was going to turn out to be wonderful, but we had no idea, and that was Dong Yan Zhu. So 02-03, we hired some other people. I hired Matt Rose for help with our K-12 outreach. Keith Watson. Keith is here. Keith was here. Keith was a student in the Coase Laboratory and went to Sun for a while and then came back and worked as a research scientist at the center. This symposium that year, Howard Schmidt, who was the advisor to the president on cyber matters, came and gave the keynote, and while here decided he was going to quit his job at the White House for the first time. I had him back as a keynote several years after that, and while here he decided to quit his job at the White House. And I started getting calls from White House staff saying, stop inviting our people to your symposium. So at the 5-year mark, we had graduated 25% of all the PhDs in the field for the prior 5 years. We had a thriving affiliate program with other universities, including Georgetown, George Washington, NCSU, John Marshall, Syracuse, UC San Diego, AFET, University of Nebraska at Lincoln, New Mexico State, SUNY Albany, Tennessee Tech, Georgia Tech, West Point and a number of others. And what we were doing there was helping them build their own programs. We wanted to have more places producing graduates that we could hire as faculty, and we thought this was the best way to do it. Then in 2003, a lot of things happened all at once. I had actually done a revision to two books. I was trying to write an NSF IDR proposal and manage all these other things, and basically blew out my hands. I developed a repetitive stress injury that I still have to this day if I use them too much. But it was clear I couldn't do everything involved. And Jeff Bitter, who was the dean at the time, agreed to a senior hire and brought Elisa Bertino in as our director of research. It was in 2003 then that my title was changed to executive director. We also brought in a couple other young faculty that we thought had great prospect. Ningui Li, who's a professor now in the CS department, and Christina Nitarotaru, who came back for this. Where's Christina? There she is. And these faculty also went on to great distinction over the following years. So we also, Melissa Dark had the first summer session for faculty from underrepresented minority institutions. We brought in about 20 faculty from across the United States who work at primarily minority institutions for a crash summer certificate in cybersecurity, on the condition they had to go back and develop something, at least courses at their home institutions. NSA helped fund that, and with generous donations from Intel, Addison Wesley, O'Reilly, Symantec, and a few others. That was a great success. What I have here is out of 23 faculty, 22 passed. In 03-04, Melissa left. Didn't leave the university. She migrated over to CIT and technology, where she became an assistant dean and a professor in the department. Teresa Bennett also left. So again, I got to do another job. Jennifer Kurtz, who had been working for the state, joined in her position. And we also added Mark Rogers to the faculty. Some of you know Mark now. He eventually left, and he's now the head of CIT over in technology, still working with us. This was in the middle. This is at the six-year mark. So I said I could break in sort of six-year intervals. At this point, we'd run out of our Lilly money that we had gotten, and a lot of our startup money, and we were sort of moving forward with what we had in grants and in donations from our partners. We had adopted the philosophy all along that when faculty got grants, it was credited to their home departments, not to us. And so this created a difficulty because we didn't get any return on those funds, and the provost very kindly recognized this and made an arrangement to give us a recurring amount of money to help keep the center going, because she saw at that point how much of an impact we were having. Part of it, was we were in the midst of the Discovery Park growth, and President Giske was really only focused, well, I shouldn't say only, primarily focused on building out Discovery Park, and we had predated that, and so we weren't really part of that focus. We did another summer program, we did all kinds of workshops, and I'm not going to go through all of that, but that was the year that NSF started the Cyber Trust program. So there were two programs that NSF started. One was the Scholarship for Service, and the other was Cyber Trust, and both had come from designs that I presented in congressional testimony in 98, right in December of 97, and had been in consultation with White House staff and committee staff in Congress, and they finally got them rolled out, and I spent a semester on partial leave at NSF to help get that started, but that also meant that I couldn't be involved in soliciting the funds. So, the following year, we were renewed as a CAE. The first Cyber Trust annual meeting was held, and 1/8 of all of the awards made by NSF that year in security across the whole United States were to Purdue faculty. It was a really proud moment that we had that many of our faculty recognized. I was trying to write an Engineering Research Center proposal for NSF. There were some interesting behind-the-scenes things there about putting me on the Faculty of Engineering, so it would be an engineering proposal. We made it to one of the three finalists, but were not accepted in the final round because they said we weren't engineering enough. The National White Collar Crime Center opened a local office with us and assigned Tim Wedge, one of their staff, who then proceeded to create a set of courses for police and law enforcement throughout the Midwest that he was regularly teaching out of Sirius with some of our support. So that went on for the next 3 years. What happened over the next couple of years, without going into detail, the next 6 years, were leaner times for us, because not only were we not getting as much support through the university, but the market took a big downturn, and many of our partners decided it simply wasn't something they could afford to do, which was unfortunate for us, because it vastly reduced our reserves. Randy did a marvelous job in paring away things in the budget and finding a way for us to remain viable during that time. But it also had other tolls. So Jennifer Kurtz left, and we hired somebody who was recommended to us by one of our former employees who was working over in athletics. And you may have heard of Joel Rasmus. So Joel over here. Joel came in as our manager of development and basically didn't know anything about security. He sat in on my class the first semester he was here and surprisingly still stayed with us. So he came up to speed quite well, and of course now he's the managing director. We also lost Matt Rose that year. How many of you know who Matt Rose is? We're local here. Yeah, I figured you would. So Matt Rose was our educational specialist, and he approached me one day and he said, "Spaff, I've got an opportunity. It's risky. I have to leave my job here at the university that I love, but it's a chance to do something new, and I want your advice." And I said, without hesitation, "If it's something that intrigues you, go do it. You're young enough, you don't have kids. You'll have a job here if you want when you come back. But if you don't take the chance, you'll regret it forever." Matt is the general manager for Nine Irish Brothers. It was a good choice for him. And I still would give him, if I had the authority and the funding, I'd give him a job if he came back, because he's really, really good at that. But we lost several people there that year. And in 08-09, we had an absolute crash in funding. Almost wiped out our reserves. We had to trim a few people back to part-time, and that was a very difficult year. The following year, 09-10, Pascal departed for ITAP, and one of our personnel, Ed Finkler, went to ITAP. Randy helped broker that because we simply didn't have the money to pay them anymore. We had really reached a low point in our funding. We also lost our webmaster at that point, Ed Finkler, and then Mike Ficozzi. And where's Mike? Oh, with a camera. So Mike came in as our web manager and general all-around design guy and database person. So the year after that, Joel helped reorganize some of our partner relations that we had. And this is at the end of the 12-year period, the second six-year period. So the theme through that six-year period was struggling to manage in a time of downturn. And we really had some doubts about how we would proceed, because we were unable to get the sponsor support, we didn't have a big program through NSF or otherwise, and we were certainly not a priority of the university administration at the time. In 2012, things began to look up. We attracted a few more sponsors. The Global Policy Research Institute was founded at Purdue, with Arden Bement as the director, and that was something that Melissa and I both got involved in immediately. In 12-13, Sam Lyles, one of our graduates, came back as faculty in CIT. Elisa Bertino took the helm of another center at Discovery Park called the Cyber Center, in addition to continuing to be the director of research with Sirius. RSA and Cypress opened their local offices. Mitch Daniels came in as president. A number of our sponsors came back after they had recovered with their finances. We started a security policy certificate, which is effectively a half a master's degree that could then be done for security policy. Things were beginning to look up. Then really for the next 6 years, things sort of settled back, not as badly as the first 6 years, but again, changes. So Christina left us to go to Northeastern. We added a few others. In 2015, Randy Bond left to go to CS to become the assistant to the director over there. But Joel moved up, took on new responsibilities, redefined the job. I spent time complaining about how some of our funds were being taken from us by the dean. And I'm not going to go into that, but we believe it was rather unfair that some of our sponsor money, our recurring funds, were being taken by the dean to pay for his needs. And I also brought up some issues about promises that weren't kept by the dean and the previous provost, resulting in my becoming the director emeritus, not by choice, because it was announced the morning of the symposium that year, which was not exactly the best timing either, but I think it sent a message. By the way, that dean and provost are no longer here at Purdue, so I outlasted them. I'm sure they had the best of motives, but it just didn't work well for us. But what we have done since then is we've made continued progress. We have more students than ever. We have more faculty than ever. The number of our sponsors has moved up. I forgot to mention that Jerry Hahn joined us at about that time, and that's something that helped too. So Dong Yan took on the role of interim dean with some reluctance, but he's done a very nice job of holding the helm. Joel and Jerry have done a tremendous job in reshaping our programs, bringing in additional sponsors. We have a wonderful event here. We have, I think you've seen the first day of the symposium, wonderful work by the students, if you go through and look at the posters, on lots of different topics. And this is, I believe, only about two-thirds of our existing projects. Some of the students didn't respond, and others, because of confidentiality agreements and others, have not submitted something. But we continue to make progress. We're doing well, as was noted, as the leading educational and research center in the United States, if not the world, in information security, and we seem to be getting better. So, as 20 years have passed by, hard to believe, the change that I've seen in terms of the number of people involved, 20 years ago, it was possible for a person with some study to know everything there was to know about cybersecurity. Now, there are about 30 different specializations, and if one person can master two of those, they're doing well. The field has exploded in knowledge and in application. Privacy has become a standard item in the news, as have security of our voting machines, our bank machines, our credit bureaus. The opportunities here for students, for research, for service to the community, the things that are foundational to being a land-grant university, seem unlimited. I don't think I'll be here for the next 20 years, maybe. If I listen to my wife's advice and stay off segues, maybe. But I hope all of you will be. I hope you will share in our success, share in our growth, and wish us well as we start the next 20 years of Sirius. So thank you all for being here. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, just a few more minutes, and then I promise we're back to business as usual.
You heard earlier tonight that SPAF has won probably every award known to man in the world of cybersecurity. But there was one he didn't even know about. And that's the award we're going to present him tonight from the staff. So we worked behind his back. We argued over who should do this. And they said, well, you obviously, you're the most expendable. Get up there and do this and see what happens. So that's why I'm here. I'm here to present SPAF with a very special award. And I just let you reach in the bag here and see what's in there.
I don't reach blindly into bags. That's why.
Spaffies, so we and I'll say this for tomorrow morning, but there's more than one Spaffy, just so you know.
There's only one Spaffy, more than one Spaffy.
So what we were going to do is, and to be honest, Spaff was very good tonight at making sure this is all about the center and all about the growth of the center. So while we did this behind his back, we're going to take advantage of his personality a little bit, and we're going to talk about the Purdue Day of Giving tomorrow. And in the Purdue Day of Giving, if someone would like to donate $100 to Sirius during that April 25th Day of Giving, we'll send you home with a SPAF. So that's our deal. So that's all I have to say about it tonight. We'll be talking about that more tomorrow. So anyway, thank you very much, and congratulations, SPAF.